Good morning to one and all. So in this video we are going to learn how to program with ARM processor, especially on ARM Cortex M3 programming. Myself Girish M, working as assistant professor in department of ECATMEC Mysore. So in this video what actually the syllabus consists, according to the video syllabus, that is for 6M embedded controller lab 15ECL67. Here in this lab we are going to have two parts, namely part A and part B. So part A consists only two programs that we need to conduct using software tool KLMUSION 4. So here you can observe that first one program is CLP to multiply two 16-bit binary numbers, and second one is to find the sum of first 10 integer numbers. Okay, in the part B, so we are going to have the 11 programs. That 11 programs has to conduct the using hardware kit. That hardware kit may be provided by different vendors, but they should have the ARM Cortex version of the microcontroller. Here you can see that first program is display hello world message using internal UART. Second program is internal interface and the control of a DC motor. Third one is interface a stepper motor and rotate in the different direction, and determine the digital output for a given analog input using internal ADC and the ARM controller, internal ADC of ARM controller, and interface DAC to generate different waveforms, and interface 4x4 keyboard and display the key code on an LCD, and using the internal PWM of a ARM controller, generate a PWM signal and vary its duty cycle, demonstrate the use of external interrupt to toggle LED to switch on and off, and display the hex digits from 0 to F on a 7-segment LED interface with an appropriate delay in between. An interface, a simple switch to display status through a relay, a buzzer, LED. Then last program to measure the ambient temperature using a sensor and spy ADC IC that is present in the kit. Okay. What do you mean by programming? Program is the information that you want to convey to the CPU. So we know that there are so many ways we are going to communicate with CPU. Since you may be used with a higher language, high level language or assembly level language, right? So what do you mean by the difference between high level language and assembly level language? So let us take a high level language. That is what we call architecture independent. So we may not be studying the architecture. So in that, only if you know the syntaxes, how we can form the syntaxes, that we can understood. If you understood all those things, then you can program with CPU by using embedded C or a C program. But medium level language, that's called as assembly level language. If and only if you know the architecture of the particular particular processor or the controller you are using. So based on that, we are going to use so many mnemonics with some assembly directives. So that is created in a specified manner. So that program, whatever the assembly level program you are going to generate, so that is fed to assembler, where assembler will give you the desired task or desired intended program in the machine level language to understand the CPU, right? So since we know that CPU can't understand whatever the language we are going to speak out, right? So either it is maybe C or it may be assembly level language, it can't understand. For that purpose, so what we are going to do, so that is converted into assembly level language. Let us understand what are the features available in ARM Cortex M3, my evaluation board that we are using, LPC1768. Okay. Before going to the program, let us understand what actually the board consists. So basically it has UART module at the left top corner, and the right top corner you have power supply section. So next to it you have 7-segment LED. So we have 4 segments over there. Okay, you can use any of that. And 16x2 LCD, you have the screen over here, you can see that. And then at the center you have the LPC1768, the controller, that is the main part, heart of the board. and we have a buzzer over here below to the power supply section, and beside to that you have a relay. So next to it there is the DC motor section, and then you have a stepper motor section. So below to it you have USB host interface. So next to it you have 4x4 key matrix, and other ADC, internal ADC. This one is internal ADC, and you have PWM section, and you have general purpose ADC and spy ADC. These are the modules that has been inbuilt in the board. Okay, this whatever the 11 programs we are listed out, so all the programs can be done with this board. If you know the what are the blacks and what are the connectors used for the particular module, if you know those things, then we can easily program it to the desired task. Let us go on actually the steps to perform the programming, or how to dump the program into this board. Let us start with the steps of keel programming. So the very first step, you need to create a project folder with your university seat number. So before creating any new project, so let us here the most important thing here, we are going to use some system configuration file. So for that purpose, if it is corrupted one, the entire project will going to vanish. So that let us have a separate folder for each project, let's say example blink LED or DC motor or etc. Okay, so let us start how after that. So open that keel tool, what we are using keel Mewvision 4 IDE software, by double clicking on the keel Mewvision icon. Then you'll get the project icon, that is the left side. You are going to get that icon or the GUI. So after that you go through the project, and then new project, and save it with the name in the respective project folder already what you have created. And then after, it will ask for new project. After creating your new project, it will ask for which device you are going to communicate, so which device you are using. So that is the target device, so we need to select that. So that is as NXP, founded by Philips, in that LPC 1768. Then say OK, and then press S again to add the startup code to the target what you have created. So you can see in the second figure, under the target you have source group is created, so under which the startup file that is required, startup file is already been added to the source group. So after, once the project has been created, so in that we need to take a file to type the program, right? So go to file, and that new, to open an editor window, create a source file. That is the source file we are using. So you need to use that, whatever the code you are going to write, you need to use the header, that is LPC17XX.h, that will be included with the system file, or that we are going to see in the next slide. So in the source file, please do add the line called as include LPC17XX.h, that because whatever the configuration, whatever the system library functions have been included in the LPC17XX header file. So then save the file. So whatever the source file you are going to save, if you save that with the extension such as .c, then the color syntax will be highlighted. Color syntax highlighting will be enabled to see the errors. That will be very convenient to see if any errors. So this is the window you can observe. So this is here the program you are going to type. After this, we need to save this program with extension C. That's the main interest here. Then after that, what we need to do, so whatever the program we have been saved in the respective folder, so then go to the target, right click on the source group and select the option add file to the source group 1, add the .c file that has been created or that has been saved in the group, or that has been saved in your folder, so that to the group. Okay, so next, the most important thing in the step, so that is again right click on the source group 1 and select the option add files to the group, and you need to add the system file that is situated in C, keel, ARM, under that startup, under that NXP folder, under that LPC17XX, under that you can observe that system underscore LPC17XX.c. So this is the system file where in which whatever the library function the required in order to run the program has been included. So that it is the most important thing we need to remember. For each and every project we need to add this system file, and importantly any changes to made this file at the current project will directly change the source system file. So for that purpose, if you change some if you do some malfunction in this system file, then whatever the project you have created, that will be altered for that purpose. So this is the important instruction to my dear students I am giving. This file should be added at each project creation. That's why I said in the earliest slide, you need to create a separate folder for each and every project. So suppose if anything happened, any malfunction happened in the flow, at that time you can remove that project and you can add, you can prepare a new one. Suppose if you not follow the step, then it may not be work properly. So that is the important step you need to remember. Then whatever the typing, whatever the program you have typed and whatever the program you have saved into the project that has been already ready now, then you can go to the project and build target. So for building all the source files such as c.asm.ah, whatever the files you have included in the target, this will create the hex file if and only if there are no warnings and no errors. If there are any errors, please debug it and let me save that program again to the target and then build again or rebuild again. So that will create your X file. That is the most important thing. That X file is going to load the dump, or we are going to dump it into the kit. Okay, for that purpose, the X file should be created. So what are the steps to create? How to download it to the LPC17168 board? So that is required only for the part B programs. Anyhow, unfortunately we have 11 programs in the part B itself. So anyhow, only 4 steps are there. So before going to dump it, so let us make sure that the connections done as follows. The connect 9-pin D sub cross cable from PC to the CN9 connector at the board. If you go back to the whatever the board we have shown, you can observe there. So whatever the UART module is there, so that serial port communication port cable, that connector is named as CN9. So we need to connect that serial communication port cable or USB to that particular connector. Then we need to check that whether that on the switch 21, whether it is in on condition or off condition. We have the switch 21, we have 2 DP switch. We need to on those 2 pins. Later let us short the jumper called as JP3. That is the most important one is in system programming, in system programming jumper. So if it is shorted, then it's good. After that we are going to open the flash magic tool. So that we need to do some settings. The settings are nothing but you need to select the device, you need to select the baud rate what is required, and then you need to browse the whatever the hex file you need to dump. And then before going to browse your file, let us make sure that you have erased all the previous blocks has been used by the previous hex file, and then verify the all the programming after finish the dumping. Okay, so please click on those two things in the flash magic tool. So once after it is opened, so let us go to the program here. We are not much concentrated on theory topics. Okay, so let us how to code it in detail. So here the ARM will make use of so many assemblers, macro assemblers, what we call it as assembler directives. So we know that assembler directives are nothing but it will going to direct the assembler in which way it is going to assign some blocks of memory, or how to start with the program, or how to allocate the desired memory to the result. So in such a way that we are going to convey, right? So assembler directives. So here the most frequently used seven assemblers we are listed out here: area, end, entry, DCB, DCW, DCD, in the space. So here the area defines the block of data of the code, end defines the end of the source file, entry defines the entry point of the program, and DCB allocates one or more bytes of memory, DCW allocates one or more half words of memory, DCD allocates one or more words of memory, then space reserves some memory locations. In the ARM, whatever the labels we are going to use, if we have not intended text, if you are not used non-intended text, at that time it will be treated as the label definition. So it will take as a label. So for that purpose, so whatever the assemblers we are going to use, that should be declared properly. Otherwise, if it is not intended, then it will going to consider it as your label definition. Let us have what actually the program structure in the ARM Cortex M3. So here you can observe that the first one is area program one. Program one is the name, user defined. Okay, you can have that. You can have whatever the name you want. Then the code read only, that is the code section you are going to initialize. The variable declaration, if any variables to be used in future, that variables can be declared. And the entry point, that defines your entry point of the program. And initialization section, in your program, if suppose let's say I need to add 10 bit 10 digit integer numbers, 10 integer numbers means you can initialize on the register with the 10 and then you can decrement it by one at a time, right? So that declaration, if you want any initialization or any initialization to what we call some register values, that can be initialized in the initialization section. And then start with the label. So that label should be like a loop or something else. So again, we jump back to that particular label. For that purpose, we need to use the label. So here you can observe that area, source code, data, read only, or you can observe that data section. That is the main part of the main body of the program. So after that, we are going to space some memory locations. Okay. So after that, we use end as the assembler directive to end the source file. So let us let us start the programming part. What we are having two programs in the software. For that purpose, for that two programs, we need to follow like this. Let us have a C program first in order to call that subroutines what we are required. Okay, let's C program start with we know the dash include lpc17xx.h because it should have so many library functions, system initialization, or the whatever the registers we are going to use, all the known architectural dependent issues will go into present in the header file. If it is included, then whatever the variables we are going to use in the with respect to the ARM controller will be known to the header file, so that the system can understand that. So it will be convert that into the desired one. So for that purpose, we need to include the lpc17xx.h. Here you can see that extern void sumten, that is the subroutine I'm going to call. For that purpose, I have initialized in the variable section and declared in the variable section, okay, declaration section. And then you can have that main body of the program, that is int main void. So first line is system init, that is nothing but system initialization, what we are going to initialize with respect to whatever the controller or the device what we have chosen for the target. Okay, so system init, so that function is included in the system file that we are going to add into the target. Okay, so for that purpose, we need to call this instruction called as system init. That is the most important, and then call your subroutine. Okay, I'm going to show that in the next slide. Okay, so after that, if you want to repeat it, repeat forever, let's say. That program, whatever the program you are looking in this slide, so it should be saved with dot extension C in your target. Okay, so in your folder, first save it in your folder, then add this dot extension C file to the source group what you have created under the target. Okay, then let us have the ASM code into the target. So let what actually it is. This is what the ASM code required for addition of 10 numbers. So you can see that area sum is the program name, code read only, export sum 10. Since I'm exporting this ASM code to the C code, I'm calling that for this function in the C code for that purpose. I used it as export that sum 10. Okay, entry point of the program and which program it is sum 10 program. Okay, so what actually it is, this is the program is to add the 10 numbers. Okay, so for that purpose, I'm taking 10 to the register 1. Okay, R1, and I'm going to store the result in R2. For that purpose, initializing the R2 register to the 0. So to make it is empty to store the result. Okay, then I'm going to start the program under the loop. Let's say add R2, R2, R1. So here add the content of R1 with the result at R2. Whatever the R2 content is there with that content, you're going to add that with the R1 content. Okay, so R1 content and R2 content will be added. Now then the result will going to store in R2. Okay, so this is what the syntax we need to use for addition in the ARM Cortex M3 microcontroller. Then do subtraction of the R1 content by 1 so that I can add 10 numbers. Since I'm initializing with 10, right, so I'll subtract it by 1, that means it will become 9. So already 10 is added with R2, that is 0. We have 10 at the R2 register. If I decrement it R1 content by 1, then R1 content will become 09. Okay, 09. So that 09 again will be added to the R2 content, that what we have present in the whatever the content present in the previous state. Let's say it is 10, then it is 9 again. So 10, 9 will be added and it will show the result in hexadecimal. So 19 is nothing but 13 you can observe in the register window after doing the stepwise execution. So till repeat the process till the whatever the R1 we have taken the register, it goes to 0. Okay, so that is the important, that is the core part of the program. Okay, so you need to add the content of R2 and R1, you need to subtract the R1 content by 1, repeat the procedure till that will become 0, that bit is not equal to 0. Okay, till that you need to repeat this instruction. After that it will jump back to the code section. Okay, it's nothing but the C program. Okay, so this is what the addition of 10 numbers ASM code. Now what we need to do, you need to save this program with the .asm is the extension. Okay, you need to save it in your folder first, and then please do add this program also to the source group. Okay, so make sure that before running the program, before building your target, you should have both .c and .asm codes in your source group. Then only it will build, it will show your result properly. Okay, then please make sure that once again, so both the program should have in the source group or the target what we have created. Okay, so after that just go back to your project and go to build target, or you can press F7. You will get if any errors are there, it will be produced in the output window. That is you can observe that the bottom corner of your keel tool while you're running. Okay, so you can observe that. Then if there are no errors, you can go to project again, you can start the debug session. So please do run for these two programs, you please do run with stepwise execution. Okay, so you can observe that system init or the whatever the code we have written step by step, you can observe the process. Okay, for that purpose you need to I'm advised to use a stepwise run. Okay, so let us go for next program. Second program, multiplication of two numbers. You can observe here it will multiply two numbers. Let's say R1 and R2 content will be multiplied. So R1 is moved with 3 and R2 is moved with 2. Okay, so that will be multiplied by the instruction called as mul R2 comma R2 comma R1. So that's nothing but multiply the content of R1 with whatever the content that is being present at R2, okay, then it will end. So it's a very simple program, but while you're running the program, please make sure that instead of calling sum10 in your C program, you should call mul2, and then it should be saved with dot extension ASM, and this program is also added to the source group, okay, whatever the target you have created under the source group, this program should be there, then only it will run properly, otherwise you may get some error. Okay, so while you're running the software programs, make sure that C code as well as your ASM code should be saved under the target. Okay, so let's start with hardware programs now. So let's how to understand the hardware programs. So the part B program, okay, so I'm taking blinking LED as an example. Why? Because I'm giving assurance that if you are able to understand this one is properly, thoroughly, if you listen this, then you can cover around 6 programs what we have listed out in the part B. Okay, so because all are related to GPIOs, since LED is connected to some GPIO port, I'm going to how to control it. Okay, I'm going to give the information about how to control it. Let us say I don't know where actually the LED being connected. For that purpose, in different vendors, whatever the kit you are going to have in your colleges, they may be brought from other wonders. For that purpose, I'm not telling that you need to follow the step only like that. Okay, so please make sure that where actually the LED is being connected. Okay, where actually the LED is being connected, the most important step we need to take is where LED is connected, we need to find out. Okay, so once you find out that, so that becomes very easy to control it. Okay, so which port number actually the LED is connected, if you know all those things, then we can easily, let's see what actually the procedure to find out. If nothing port is given in your manual at that time, we can have this. Let's see. So this is the schematic, whatever the kit we are having. Okay, so where actually the LED is connected, we need to find out that, right? So here you can observe that LD2, LD9, so they are connected to P0.4 to P0.11. Okay, you can observe at the bottom end of the circuit or the bottom end of the schematic. Okay, so here my interest is to blink the program called as LED called as LD2. Okay, where LD2 is connected, actually LD2 is connected in turn to the first pin of your CNA1. Okay, what actually is CNA1? So we are going to connect this CNA1 to the main port of the CNA, let's say CNA. Okay, so here the first pin is P0.4. okay, so we'll come to know that LD2 is connected to 0.4. once you know that, then you can control this particular bit or particular pin in the port, so that the in turn the LED is controlled. Okay, so you can observe here in this program, or in this what we call LED schematic, they are mentioned LD2, LD9 are connected to P0.4 to P0.11, but in other circuitry part they may not be mentioned, may be mentioned or may not be, it's there. For that purpose, you can find out it very easily. So where actually the LED connected to that connector, so from that connector where we are going to connect the connectors. Okay, now so the general connector, it's called GPIO port. Okay, CNA, CNA1 is connected to CNA. So in the CNA1, it's also 10 pin, it's also 10 pin, both configuration of CNA and CNA1 is same. For that purpose, I'm going to take first pin of CNA is P0.4. So P0.4 is connected to your what we call LD2. So for that purpose, now I'm considering P0.4 in my program. Okay, so first step is over. So other than these LEDs, you have so many LEDs in the hardware kit, so whatever the LED you want to run, you can find out the pin where it's connected, and you can start the program to it. Okay, so let us start. This is the first step. Am I clear in the first step? First step is to find out where LED is connected into the given. Okay, so next one, you need to configure that selected pin as GPIO. So we know that there are so many pins are connected, so many port pins are connected. So, but I don't know what actually it functions by default. Okay, for that purpose, what I need to do, I need to select or I need to configure that particular pin into the GPIO pin. I need to make that. How we can make, let us say the LPC1768 what we are having, for each port we are going to have two control pins, namely pin select 0 and pin select 1. We have 5 ports in the ARM Cortex M3 microcontroller, okay, that is LPC1768, okay, and we have around 11 pin select resistors, okay. For each port we need to have two pin select resistors, namely for port 0 pin select 0 and 1, for port 1 pin select 2 and 3, for port 2 pin select 4 and 5, for port 3 pin select 6 and 7, for port 5 pin select 8 and 9, where pin select 10 is used for tracing purpose. This is out of interest, let's see, let's ignore it, okay. So anyhow, let's take since the whatever the selected pin in the previous slide, what we have selected, that is P0.4, right, that is nothing but port 0th fourth pin, okay, 0th port fourth pin. So you can observe there the pin is highlighted, okay. So here the most important thing is need to be remembered is, in order to control a single pin in the port, we need to take 2 bits in the pin select register, okay, na? So let us take that, okay. So once you made, for your interest is P0.4, right, because LD2 is connected to P0.4, right. So now I need to make this pin as GPIO first, okay. For that purpose, these 2 bits are need to be made as 0, then your port 0.4 pin will work as GPIO in general, okay. For that purpose, now I need to make this 2 bits 0, other the rest of the bits in the pin select register should be F, okay, or should be high. So let's say the 4 content will become F, this 4 content will become F, this 4 will become F, this 4 will become F, this 4 will become F, this 4. Now I have made this one is, this is 1, this 1, and this 2 bits are 0, 1, 1, 0, 0. So it should be C, okay, it should be C, okay, 1, 1, 0, 0. So that is nothing but 12. So you can represent in hexadecimal called as C. So this is F, this is F, okay. So is my interest is P0.4 only. For that purpose, I need to make these 2 bits are 0. Then only it works as GPIO. Then what is the content to be loaded to the pin select register? F, 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 C, F, F. So you can observe in the instruction. So this is what the instruction, okay, we need to type in the program, that is example, you can say LPC, that is low power controller, underscore pin configuration or pin connection, that is with respect to the port, okay. So that is pin select 0 ampersand width, okay, ampersand and equal to 0x, that is the representation of hexadecimal, F F F F C F F. Is it right? So since my interest is P0.4, so that's commented here, P0.4 is chosen. Whichever the pin you need to control, just move 00 to that particular bit first, to that particular 2 bits first, okay, na? Then only that particular pin correspond to that will be worked as GPIO, okay. Is it clear? Am I clear in the second step now? So once you clear with the first 2 steps, so the 50% is over. Now let's see what actually the next step, okay. The next step is, so whatever the pin you are chosen, you need to change that particular pin to input or output as you required. Since LED is a output device, okay, so I need to make that whichever the pin I have selected, okay, whichever the port pin I have selected where actually the LED 2 is connected, that pin should be made as output first, okay. So that's what we call it as FIO direction, okay. FIO direction is nothing but how to do it actually, how to change the direction now. So in the previous slide, what we have changed, we have configured that pin as GPIO, but here I need to specify that whether it is input or output, okay. So in order to do that, so this is a step we need to take place, okay. So is FIO direction, that is the register, okay, we are going to use to change the direction of the required pin. Since port 0, so port 0 itself is what we have chosen, so that will be mentioned in the instruction, okay. So since port 0th fourth pin should be made, okay, 1, since it is output, as I said, In order to make it as an input, it is 0. In order to make it as an output, it is 1. Okay, since LED is a output device, I need to make this switch is 1, and then rest of the bits should be 0. Okay, so let us have the instruction. That is LPC underscore GPIO 0th port. Okay, so FIO direction are with 0x00010, because this bit is 1, so this XA is this nibble will become 1. Okay, 3 zeros and 1, so this will become 1. So just consider it and 10, since P0.4 our LED connected is the LED's output is considered. Okay, so what actually next is, you have selected the pin and you have configured that as a GPIO and you have changed the direction as output. Then what you need to do? Then you need to send the bits. That's it. Okay, so in order to send the bit, that's the last step we need to do. So you can observe here. Okay, you can observe here both sending 1 and D0 to the particular bit selected. Okay, so now send the bit to the particular LED selected. Okay, if you're sending the 1 and 0 for the particular port pin, then obviously that 1 and 0 will be sent to the LED connected there. So that LED will be on and off respectively, whatever the data you have sent. Okay, you can observe here. So in order to set it to the on condition, so the bit should be high. So whatever the data you have loaded in the previous stage, the same data can be loaded here, but the instruction is FIO set. FIO set means fast input output set. So which bit should be set? This bit should be set. Highlighted bit should be set. Okay, na? So 0000010 to on the LED. Is it clear? Then in order to clear, shall I make it to 0? No, it's not required. Okay, you just highlight the bit by 1 only, but you need to call this instruction called as FIOCLR. Instead of set, you need to call FIOCLR. So that obviously that instruction, that highlighted bit will be cleared by this instruction. So here you can observe that LPC underscore GPIO 0 iPhone greater than symbol FIO fast input output clear, which indicates that selected bit will be cleared. Okay, so to off the LED. Let us see the program now. Okay, so you can see the program now, what we have conveyed in the last 4 slides. So just recall those things. Okay, so first step is hash include LPC17XXHH, so 17XX.h, and then start up the program int main void. Okay, so let us start. I'm using, since so switching on the on and off the LED will be should be visible to the human being, so for that purpose I'm introducing delay. Okay, unsigned integer I, system init, system initialization, so system core clock update. This is the most important thing we need to add here. Why we call actually the arm as low power controller means whatever the core clock we are going to have to the device, that can be sent to the required module only. For that purpose, then we can save the power, that instead of wasting the power to all the modules by powering all the modules. Okay, so here in the selected module can be powered separately. Okay, so that's what we call it as system core clock update. How it is generalized, how it is shared, entire thing is there in the system file. Okay, for that purpose we need to add this instruction, system core clock update. Okay, so now let us have the first stage. What is the first stage? We need to find out the pin. We have found that the P0.4 is connected to GP the LED2, right? So for after that, what we have done, we have configured that as a GPIO pin, right? So for that purpose, what the instruction used, LPC underscore pin configuration. So pin select ampersand with 0xFFFFCFFF, right? So that is depending upon the data or the port pin selected. Okay, since it is a P0.4, that data is like that. If you want to select other ports, then you can change the change that particular value to be loaded, okay, into the pin select register. Then so what is the next step? What we done, we have changed the direction, right, as input or output, right? So here LED's device is output device, so for that purpose I need to make it as output. For that purpose, that particular port pin should be made as high. Okay, for that purpose we have done LPC underscore GPIO 0 FIO direction R with a particular value, that is 1 to the P0.4, okay, that is data is 0000010. Okay, so then what we need to do after configuring GPIO, after changing the direction, what we need to do? I need to send the data, right? So that sending of the data will comes in while loop. Okay, so you can observe that first one is set, so to switch on the LED. So whatever the data you have been taken in the FIO set instruction, that data is loaded here. So I have called some delay. Okay, so call some delay, some value you can load, 10,000, 20,000, whatever you want. Okay, so since we are not concentrated on the what we call the delay of 1 second, we not calculated it. So for that purpose, generally I have called 30,000 for some time delay. So then I will switch off that LED by using the instruction called as FIOCLR. Is it clear? So after that I call delay again. I need to close that while loop brackets, then it will be repeated forever. That means you can visualize the blinking of LED in your kit. Okay, so this is what the programming for blink the LED. Okay, now let's start with the one, how to control the buzzer. Okay, so now the time is yours, how to do the program. So let us start where actually it's been connected first, right? As I said, where actually it is connected. Fine, so buzzer is connected here, thing is in 8. So where actually the in 8 is connected? In the 8th pin. So where it is? In the CNA 5. So then I need to look back to CNA in the 8th pin, right? So in CNA, I need to look at the 8th pin. So you can see that the CNA 8th pin is 0.11. That's it. Once you find out this, pin, then the program is over. Okay. So now your pin is 0.11. Then can you tell me what may be the data to be loaded for this 11th pin? So go back to the previous slide. Okay, whatever having the GPIO. Okay, and take that value and 11th pin where actually the two bits of pin select register has mapped, that bit should be 0. Okay, make that and get me the value. Okay, we'll give the program directly, so you can after showing that, after changing the value, you can observe that it is 3 at the what we call 0, 1, 2, 4, 3, 4, 5, 5th nibble. Okay, in the 5th nibble, it will become 3. Okay, so then, so the pin select register is chosen. Then, since buzzer is also output device, so that particular 11th pin should be made 1 in the FIO direction. So, make it that. So, you'll get the value called as 0000800, then on and off the buzzer. There's nothing but set the same value, clear the same value. Okay, so clear it and set it. Okay, so in between those, call some delay. That's it. Okay, very simple. It will be repeated forever, and you can observe that the buzzer will going to run, buzzer will going to sound with some delay. That is what we have mentioned here. Okay, so this is the very simple steps to program the buzzer. Okay, let us start next one. How to program the how to control the relay, program to control the relay. Let's say where actually the relay is connected. Okay, so you can observe RIL. So the pin is RIL, is connected somewhere to the relay DPT switch. Okay, DPDT switch. Now I need to find out where actually the relay is present. So where actually the relay is present? So you can observe here relay. So relay is connected to the output 4. Okay, output 4 in what? ULN2803. ULN2803 is the driver, line driver. Okay, so that nothing but output 4 is nothing but will be fed from IN4. Okay, so IN4 is connected to the IN5. Where IN5 actually? So since this is also the present in same section where actually the buzzer is located. So CNA 5. Okay, so in that CNA 5, where actually the IN 5, and this nothing but 5th pin. Okay, so 5th pin is 0.8. If you find out that it's 0.8, then it's very simple. Okay, so you can observe this 5th pin here. 5th pin in the is connected to the P0.8. Okay, once if you know that pin, then it is very simple to program it, right? So let us start the program. 0.0. Okay. So 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, 0.8. The highlighted, So whatever the one value we're going to have in the red color, okay? So red color. So that's what the eighth pin, okay, in the port pin, in the port zero, okay? The port zero, eighth pin is highlighted, okay? That's I need to make, okay? So then you can see the value here itself, 0000100, okay? You can observe that. So after making the direction, after made my selected pin direction is output, what do we need to do? We need to send the data, that's it. FIO set, FIO clear. So these are the four instructions we need to remember to control GPIO. Once you know this four instruction, what we have shown in the previous slide, I'll control the buzzer or control the LED or control the relay. Okay, if you know the four instruction, what do we call pin select na, pin select zero, or the whatever the configuration of pin select, and the FIO direction, and then FIO set, and then FIO clear. Okay, once you know this, then six programs, namely first one is LED, buzzer, relay, that is completed, as we know that in the video itself we have covered. Okay, and then DC motor, but actually the DC motor which is connected to single bit, one bit, right? So that is, if you are able to know the, how to control that particular bit, then you can, right? Then go back to stepper motor. What actually it is? Instead of single pin, it is four pin, a step. Fine. It's a four pin. Then just what we call control the pins in the whatever the sequence you want. Okay. Let's say stepper motor have A, B, C, D as the four coils. Let's say A is excited and A is switched off. B is excited and B is switched off. And C is excited and C is switched off. And then D is excited and D will be made off. Okay. So this is what the sequence we need to control it in code, to run it in clockwise or in anti-clockwise. Let us see. So apart from that, what do you need to do? You need to select the GPIO pins where actually the stepper motor is connected. That's the one. You can do that, right? So after that, you can have a ADC program. Okay. So ADC program is also like that. So, but internally ADC is there in the kit. So you have to find out where actually it has been connected. Then find out the program and make it. Okay, there is no need to have any other function since ADC pin is connected. Send the data to that. Okay, send the data to it. So that will be converted into digital value and it will go into display in the LCD display. Okay, so after that, what we have, digital to unlock converter, DAC. Okay, so if you go to that again, where actually it is connected, find out the digital pin where it is connected. Send the data to the in the required manner to that particular digital pin, then it will convert into unlock and it will give the waveform required. Okay, so these are the programs, and along with that, not only this, we can have what is that, 4x4 keypad, right? So that is also very simple, 4x4. So there are 16 switches. Instead of one switch, you have 16 switch. That's it. You need to control the 16 switch by row wise scanning, by column wise scanning. That's it. Very simple the procedure to find out. Okay, and I think I hope all of you clear with the things what we have conveyed till now. Okay, so let us have the program in the laboratory. Okay, thank you one and all.